Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this training webinar on the Thales Canon. My name is Winston Brady, and I'm the Director of Curriculum and Thales Press here at Thales Academy. In today's webinar, we're going to go over, one, the goal of history, two, learning activities across the canon, across the Thales Canon, and then section three, we're going to look at practice informative assessments, ways of testing your students and evaluating just how much they've picked up over the course of your particular unit. But let's start off with the goal of history. So history, as the name implies, is ultimately a story. And great history, at its best, is going to be the most engaging and exhilarating story. It's a story told about the past that contains meaningful insights about the present, insights that inspire better choices for the future. At Thales Academy, our goal is to educate the whole student, aiming at the head as well as the heart, integrating content with character, enlightening minds, and empowering students to achieve their highest potential. Meanwhile, the goal of the Thales Canon is to provide students with a survey of the Western canon with a particular influence on good character development. So we're tying events and figures and broad themes in history with the type of character formation that's really integral to a classical education, as well as looking at the truth and rigorous academic inquiry. The Thales Canon is meant to be a combination workbook and textbook that's going to bring together an engaging storyline of history, along with studying resources like maps, timelines, direct instruction scripts, and primary sources in what I consider to be a very beautiful layout that makes history really come alive for students and teachers. The goal is to make it easier for teachers to teach and students to study everything that is good, true, and beautiful. As far as the scope and sequence for the Thales Canon, right now we have four volumes of the Thales Canon in print. Volume one is the Bronze Age, which covers the beginnings of which covers historiography, the Neolithic Revolution, Sumer, Egypt, and then ends with the collapse of the Bronze Age, circa 1177 BC. The second quarter, normally there's going to be some overlap from the end of one quarter and the beginning of the next, but the second quarter is going to pick up where the first quarter left off with the Late Bronze Age, plus units on ancient India and ancient China, and then the Iron Age Near East, like the Neo-Babylonian Empire, the Neo-Assyrian Empire, and the Persian Empire. The third quarter, we're going to be wrapping up the Iron Age and then moving into the Greeks. And that's what we'll focus on mostly for today's webinar, since with our scope and sequence and our pacing, most Thales teachers are moving into that fourth volume of the book entitled The Greeks. Fourth quarter, finishing up any sections of the Greek textbook that a teacher may have left off, and then moving into the Romans and then into the early church. Just the way that we've laid out our historical sequence at Thales Academy. Sixth grade is ancient history, and it begins with the beginnings of history with Sumer and Egypt, and then it ends with the fall of the Roman Empire. So we're going from around 4000 BC up to 476 AD. But let's go into some learning activities across the canon. So if you were to open up the Thales Canon textbook, the first 1 to 4 pages of each chapter is typically going to look like this. They're going to have opening questions that are tied to a primary source or some sort of cool learning activity tied to the unit at hand. These opening questions are meant to solicit a sense of wonder at the beginning of a particular unit. They should be graded for completion with a point value that is relatively small. If I were teaching these courses, it'd probably be on the order of 5 points upwards to 15 or 20 points, just depending how many questions are accompanying this initial academic exercise. Most of these opening activities are going to be either primary sources that I think are fairly illustrative of the civilization covered in the chapter. So here I've got an adaptation from Hesiod's Works and Days that covers the beginnings of Greek mythology and an overview of Greek cosmology. And the idea there is to give the kids kind of a sense of the big picture and the worldview that the Greeks are operating from. Other times it's going to be the coolest fact that I could, that I can dream up, that I can find about that particular civilization. As far as implementing these activities, I would distinguish between two of these different types of opening activities, opening questions. Some of them are going to be fairly reading heavy. And so if they're like this, like the example that I have on screen with the creation and the misery of man, I would recommend reading these in class while asking students to summarize important passages or allowing students to read such texts for their homework. If some of these opening activities are more reading light, perhaps they're focusing more on an archaeological dig or something, some really cool artifacts found with the civilization, I would give students maybe 10 to 15 minutes at the beginning of class to read through the prompts and answer the questions, and then go over those questions, perhaps using some seminar habits. You can solicit answers on the whiteboard, but refrain from telling the students the right answer until they really work through it. The next large section in any particular chapter in the Thales Canon are really just these narrative sections. So history, as I stated, is really meant to be a great and exhilarating story. And so the bulk of the Thales Canon chapters are really devoted to a walkthrough of the historical period and the people at hand. So each chapter contains a series of these narrative sections that walk through the civilization under review. And covering the material, two ideas to keep in mind. As far as implementation for these narrative sections, you could ask the students to read these sections at home, just as part of their homework. At Thales Academy, we do have a homework policy that asks that teachers are very meaningful and very purposeful about the homework that they assign to students. So you do want to keep a pulse on your class to see just how well they're doing with the assignment. But really, this sort of reading material is meant to help the students learn that material before they come to class the next day. So in my mind, it is permissible to assign students a little bit of reading before class the following day. Perhaps one page, perhaps upwards of four pages. I try to intermix these pages with a lot of graphics, diagrams, photos, big idea text box, vocabulary lists, and so on. So even if they were assigned four pages, it's not quite four pages. But I really leave that up to you guys as the teacher to figure to decide what would work best for your classroom. The other idea is to read through this narrative material together as a class. Again, if I were teaching it, the way that I would structure a typical class period is to have a student read through maybe one paragraph or maybe upwards of two, maybe even three paragraphs. And as they're reading, I would pay careful attention to any words that the student may stumble over. If they can't pronounce a word like the word there bolded, that's helos, if they mispronounce it as helis or helis or something like that, why don't we just pause for a second and give the students an opportunity to repeat that word. I'll give them the definition. If they don't know how to pronounce it, they probably don't know what it means either. If the student reading that particular word doesn't know what the word means, then there's gonna be other kids in the class that don't know it either. So I'll pause at those sections. Then once they finish reading their particular section, I might ask a student at random in the class to provide a summary, or if I have thought of some really good questions tied to the reading, I might ask those questions as well. I'm not going to drag out this question and answering session just for the sake of talking and so forth. But what I want to do is keep the kids engaged and on their toes. I want to ask the students questions in order to drive engagement, check for understanding, and just kind of create a real palatable energy as we go through reading that material together. In each narrative section, typically at the very beginning, there's going to be a big idea, which is a way of distilling down all the really important information in the chapter into one sentence or two, something that the students really can walk away with once the reading is over. It's the one thing that I really want them to remember by the time, you know, the unit, the period that you guys are learning about is over with. So these narrative sections are really going to be the main means of instruction as far as taking all of this content and breaking it down and then passing it on to your students. You could do that by, I mean, A, asking the students to read it beforehand for homework, and then they can do the reading comprehension questions the next day in class as part of a bell ringer maybe, or you can read those together with your students in class and have a kind of guided reading, modeled guided reading, where students read through a particular paragraph and you ask students questions in order to drive engagement and check for understanding. I had mentioned that there are reading comprehension questions that the students can do after reading through a particular section. These questions typically follow every 2 to 5 pages, and they're meant to draw students' attention to some important tidbits, important themes, ideas that were covered in the chapter. Since they're reading comprehension questions, they're really meant to be a fairly low on the RBT scale, the revised Bloom's taxonomy. They're not asking students to provide a deep level of analysis. Really, they're just meant to regurgitate information. Regurgitate isn't the best teacher word, but it's pretty applicable right here. The material provides students information, reading comprehension questions. I just want students to repeat it and show that they have internalized it just that much. For implementing these sorts of assignments, some suggestions, maybe once you finish reading a particular section, you could ask students to complete it silently and take it for a completion grade. You can ask students to complete these reading comprehension questions as part of a bell ringer. Maybe the students read that particular section the night before, and so they're going to answer the questions once they arrive in class the next day. So you don't have to read everything that came before, but you can go over these questions with the class and just see how well the students understood the material that was presented to them. As far as time, anywhere from 5 minutes to 15 minutes, even with a bell ringer where students come into class and they find this assignment waiting for them, I can call that my first five. I can list 5 minutes on the board, but typically it will roll into about maybe 15 minutes or so. But that's a good way to start off the class, is having an exercise like this ready and waiting for them. In each of these Thales Canon textbooks, I have a series of activities that I've called closer look activities. These are interspersed throughout each chapter, and they're meant to provide a kind of break, a meaningful expedition into something particularly cool that the students really should learn about. So it's just really meant to be a break so that they're not constantly reading and answering questions, but they're doing some of the fun analysis for which we, you know, history teachers like us really began to fall in love with history. For the Greeks, a number of closer look activities that are in store for you guys include some sections on identifying Greek pottery. I list some characteristics of Greek pottery as far as, you know, a really ornate design, like red figure pottery versus black figure pottery versus geometric designs. Those sorts of designs typically tell you the time period that the pot was made. And so I've got a cool activity, cool worksheet effectively, where students can guess when a particular pot was made based on, you know, the presence of geometric designs or flowers or red figures, black figures, and what have you. Also identifying Greek architectural orders and different types of constitutions, you know, from a democracy to a monarchy to a republic. So it's really meant to kind of give something of a hands-on experiment, the closest thing that we can find in a history class to the kinds of hands-on experiments that the kids would do in science. As far as time, I would budget maybe one class period to doing one such activity, maybe once a week. And I would recommend to take these exercises, these closer look activities, really for a completion grade. With these completion grade, I'll go back to the reading comprehension questions, but you know, students should write and complete sentences. It really should be probably multiple sentences depending on how tough the question is and what it's asking. But completion also means completion. So it really should, you know, each question should be answered, you know, to your satisfaction. It should be done in pencil, should be done in complete sentences, shouldn't be done in crayon with a lot of like emojis to express what happened during that historical period. But it should be something the kids are taking seriously. For completion grades, though, generally, I look to make sure that the students have completed it, and then I'll give 100% or maybe 75%, 50%, 25%, just kind of a sliding scale like that, depending on the number of questions. On the reading comprehension sheet that I've got here, there's four questions, so maybe each of those is worth 25 percentage points. But the idea there is just to encourage the students to take the assignment seriously and to work as hard as they can while they're in class together with you. Here's another such closer look activity based off of some frescoes found at the Palace at Knossos in Minoan Crete. Just to kind of give a sense of what you can do with these, you can give the students maybe 20, 25 minutes or so to look through each of these pictures. At first, I would ask the students to be pretty silent, you know, maybe 10 minutes of good, quiet think time, and then they can answer the questions that accompany at the end of the exercise. At the conclusion of that 10 minutes, if you feel like they can handle it, the students can share their answers with a partner, right? I think pair share is a pretty common activity for students in middle school. Once they've shared their answers with a partner, then you can solicit answers from the class, write those up on the whiteboard, see how students did. With these particular frescoes, I'll just give you guys the trick to it. But at the Palace of Knossos, they have these beautiful, beautiful frescoes, paint that's done on wet plaster. But it typically is scenes of like dolphins and dancing and bull riding and really crazy mythical animals. There's nothing even remotely linked to warfare, things that the Minoans would really need to defend themselves from their hostile neighbors across the Aegean, across the Wyandot Sea, the Mycenaeans, and they're coming up in the next page after this closer look activity here. So hopefully the students would get that, yeah, the Minoans are really talented artists, really beautiful works of art that they're able to put together and decorate, but they don't focus on warfare and defending themselves at all. And it'll show up in how easily they're taken over by the Mycenaeans in the very next page. Another of these closer look activities, this comes in chapter 4 of the Greeks with classical Greece in the Peloponnesian War. Most people right now are driving home. So I'll ask a couple of guiding questions about how I would do this. This particular map here, it's the Aegean world. It's color-coded according to the power and control of that particular territory. If you're familiar with the Peloponnesian War, it's effectively a civil war between Sparta and her allies on the one hand and the Athenian Empire on the other hand. The Athenian Empire here is color-coded with a nice Mises magenta, whereas Sparta and her allies Corinth and other kind of central Greece, the Peloponnesian Peninsula and parts of Boeotia, but they are in Milesian mint. The Persian Empire is in scholar's gold, and so on and so forth. But if you were a Athenian statesman or some sort of Athenian politician, if you were looking at that map, what would bother you? What would give you the most concern? What's that one thing, perhaps the easiest thing, that you would want to change? So you'd want to give the students some quiet think time to look at this particular map here. And if I imagine that the students would probably be very scared about Persia, right? That giant swath of scholar's gold across Asia Minor. The Persian Empire, that great threat from the previous chapter, the previous war, the Persian Wars and the invasion of Xerxes, and an empire made up of 1,000 nations that drank whole rivers dry, that could blot out the sun with their volley of arrows. Yeah, the Persians would probably be pretty scary. But it should really catch the students' attention that the thing that scared the Athenians the most was not this huge empire here that was still on their back doorstep, but actually this tiny island here called Melos. If you look, all the islands in the Aegean Sea are colored, color-coded with that beautiful Mises magenta. So all the islands off the coast of Asia Minor, everything except for Crete. Crete's kind of cool and independent. That's cool. But all these islands that are really close to Athens, especially the small ones, they're all part of the empire. They're all on that same team as the Athenians. Everyone except for Melos. And if you're familiar with the Peloponnesian War, you're probably familiar with the Melian Dialogue, when a group of Athenian diplomats lands on the beaches at Melos and basically orders them to join the Athenian Empire or be conquered, subjugated, and you know their tiny little island would just be wiped out and absorbed into the growing Athenian Empire. And Athens wanted to do that simply because it's the one part of the Aegean, that the one island that's not already part of Athens. And they really can't stand to let anybody be independent like that. So they have to go after them. And it's really fascinating because it's actually hiding in plain sight throughout the whole of the chapter that all of these islands are Mises magenta, everybody except for Melos right here. And the Melian Dialogue, which is a really great primary source text that is included in this volume of the Thales Canon, but that's what the Athenian envoys open up with, that that Melos isn't part of Athens and Athens Empire, and so they either need to join or face the consequences. And you can see that really well on this particular map right here. If you play your cards right, you can get the kids to see it too. So just something fun to look forward to. Now, I mentioned primary sources like Thucydides and the Melian Dialogue. You know, we're a classical school, and classical education typically relies more on the actual documents and the texts written at or near the time of the events under discussion. That way, the historical period really speaks for itself. We're not reading through these individuals through the viewpoint, the worldview, the lens of the author who's penning the textbook, but we're really looking at these events through the eyes of the historians who provided such deep and meaningful insights about such historical events. For various texts that I chose and dropped into the Thales Canon, they include the likes of Herodotus and Xenophon and Thucydides. In the Romans, we'll have Livy and Polybius and Tacitus and the like. But these individuals, these historians, and other like-minded authors, chroniclers, diarists, newspapermen, what have you, we love reading their particular writings because they really illuminate the period under discussion. And they help us to understand not only their world, but also our world. The insights that a historian like Thucydides poured into his History of the Peloponnesian War are so meaningful and insightful because he really uses the war as a vehicle to talk about human nature and the ways in which people, ordinary people, people like us, make decisions under great duress and great struggle. So we can learn a lot about ourselves and the way that we deal with suffering, deal with hardship, the nature of the good life. We can deal and learn about all those things by reading these primary sources. So just, you know, if you're ever wondering, what should I read with students that may help some light bulbs go off in their minds concerning the period that we're studying, find those texts that help students not only understand that period, but our world. Not only their world, but our world. one wonderful one that's coming up with the Persian Wars. Herodotus writes about the invasion of Xerxes into Greece. And he presents it as this great act of hubris that is symbolized in Xerxes literally crossing over this boundary that was meant to hem in and limit the growth of the Persian Empire. Xerxes literally goes over the boundaries that had been allotted to the Persian Empire. And going beyond such boundaries, Xerxes invited upon himself his own destruction, his own doom, the dissolution of his army, and the slow but inevitable decline of the Persian Empire. Well, I mean, how many times are kids told that, like, hey, here's the line, here's the limit, you shouldn't go past this point, otherwise you may risk getting in a lot of trouble. How often do we tell kids, this is where you should go and no further, and they completely ignore us? It's a wonderful text, really fun to read with students, not least because Xerxes' megalomania is on full display, whipping the Hellespont and the like, punishing it for swallowing up some of his boats. It's great stuff. With these primary sources, depending on the length, I would budget 1 to 2 class periods. I'd only pick 1 or 2 documents per unit, though. So 1 to 2 class periods per document, but maybe only 1 or 2 documents per unit. It can seem really overwhelming for kids for sixth graders in particular, right? These kids are at the very beginning of their academic journey, but it can seem a little overwhelming for them if they're reading nothing but Thucydides. They need you, the teacher, to help them understand and interpret the significance of the events that they're reading about. So just to encourage you guys in that, seminar teaching, seminar habits, very important. But with sixth grade, go for quality over quantity. You're modeling for them what it's like to read an influential and significant work of literature or history or philosophy, and really enjoy the process. You're modeling for them what it's like to read a work of great value and love it. So if you can't, you know, if you're getting through the unit, you're looking at your pacing guide, you don't know how you're going to cover, I think, the 3 different excerpts from Thucydides that I included in the Thales Canon, that's totally okay. Shoot for 1 seminar that really helps students connect a lot of the dots between the period that they're talking about and the period that they're currently living through, right? Your class period. And each chapter in the Thales Canon, from volume 1 up through volume 4 in the Greeks, ends with a series of review activities, the first of which is a script for direct instruction. And these are always labeled as direct instruction review. So DI is a powerful pedagogical tool whereby teachers ask students a series of call and response questions. The answers are typically pretty short, maybe 1 to 4 words, so that the students as a class can respond back with the aim of learning this material to mastery. So it's a means of helping students memorize large chunks of information. It's a tool that we utilize heavily in kindergarten through 5th grade. It's a really powerful way of teaching math, fluency, and phonics. And I tried to build the strength of this tool into the Thales Canon with these call and response scripts, similar to what a kindergarten through 5th grade teacher may find in some of his or her materials. Typically, these questions are tied to the most important events or figures or themes in the chapter under discussion. You're more than welcome to use these questions too to write some of your tests, although you'll find out very shortly that that's already been placed into a Thales test bank for 6th grade. I would encourage you to seek out coaching from your administrator, particularly those teachers who are at K-8 campuses. Coaching particularly for this skill here, the K-8 administrators, this is their wheelhouse. They are so gifted when it comes to leading large groups of students in a DI-driven lesson. But for us as middle school teachers, DI is fantastic for managing large middle school classes. So when I was teaching sixth grade up through eighth grade, I leaned very heavily on my DI coaches like Miss Hillary Herman Pagliola and other administrators, because I realized that I could keep a pretty exuberant, pretty excitable group of sixth graders on task and learning meaningful content through this particular tool. So if you're looking for coaching, those sorts of observations and things like that, this would be a really good one to work through with your administrators. The next review activities typically are timeline practice sheets, and these are effectively worksheets that are tied to important dates and events covered in that particular chapter. As history teachers, we know that history is not entirely all dates, and sometimes consuming your class with studying dates can seem very tedious. And I agree that history is not all dates. It's also not less than dates. Western history is linear, with each event really influencing the one that comes after it. And the more familiarity that students have with dates, the easier it's going to be for them to retain this information. And so these timeline practice sheets are effectively a worksheet. It's the same timeline given two times over. The top timeline, the top row, is going to have some information missing from its definition, whereas the bottom timeline, the bottom row, is going to have the dates missing. So students need to look back and forth. The answers are right there on the page. I'm totally fine with that. But the goal there is that students have one exercise, one meaningful activity to review that material just a little bit. As far as time for implementing these assignments, I would go 15 minutes maybe for an exit ticket, maybe for a homework assignment or a bell ringer, something that students find when they walk into class. 15 minutes would probably be the most amount of time I would let students work on something like this. You could even make it into a game that maybe students are timed while they do this, but that's up to you. With timelines, though, the other real bread and butter activity for us history teachers are going to be maps. Geography is so valuable for students to learn today. If they don't know where events happened or how geographical features like mountains or rivers and seas may have influenced such events, it's just going to be harder for them to grasp a picture of the whole of history. So these map practice exercises typically build off of the maps in the chapter. So usually this particular map here, so for the Greek world, somewhere earlier in the chapter, there was a map with all the seas in the Mediterranean, right? The Black Sea, the Aegean Sea, the Eastern Mediterranean, the Ionian, the Adriatic, the Tyrrhenian Sea, I hope I pronounced that right, the Western Mediterranean, and then the Atlantic Ocean. And then elsewhere in the chapter, I've got all the city-states or principal landmarks scattered throughout the Greek world, centered on the Aegean Sea. Within each map practice sheet as well, I always include a little QR code, which if scanned will take students to a Thales Press administered Quizlet classroom, and they can find these particular maps available as diagrams. And so students can study these maps, you know, really to their heart's content. There are ways that you can take them for a completion grade, maybe if students take a screenshot on their iPads that they studied, you know, until they got 100% or they studied a certain amount of time, what have you. But those are other good, solid exercises just to give students more time to practice, more familiarity with the geographical place names and cities, battles, and the like that you've covered in that particular unit. And like with other exercises here, I'd go with maybe 5 to 15 minutes, providing it to students as an exit ticket, homework assignment, a bell ringer, and so on. Each chapter ends with one large writing prompt, typically with two pages of blank space for students to fill up with their thoughts and reflections on the material that they just covered. I don't necessarily expect students to write down everything, you know, to fill up all of that blank space, but it's there in case they need it. Writing is thinking, and we want to provide students with meaningful opportunities to interact with the material that they just learned. So most of the time, these questions are going to lead back to the big idea presented on the first page of each chapter. Sometimes, depending on just how important the unit is, there's multiple big ideas, but these questions for these writing prompts are really meant to cover the entire chapter and maybe some material covered in prior chapters as well. If you're giving this to students in class, I might give 20 to 45 minutes, not necessarily as a bell ringer assignment, but something that may cover the entirety of the class period, but taking that as a completion grade. And it could also be given as the essay on a test. And in that case, you're probably going to be grading more for content, more so than form and organization, like how well the students centered on a particular idea and then supported it and carried it on. With an exercise like this, you'd probably want them to relate more information about the chapter that they just finished learning about. It could be as informal as a journal prompt, and it could be as formal as a essay on a test. I try to use language of writing prompts and language like writing is thinking to try to just get the kids excited about writing. Maybe this would be something of a break. That's always a challenge to get the students to take these sorts of assignments seriously. But if you take it seriously and set those sorts of high expectations, they will certainly do so. I'm going to move now into formative and formal assessments, as well as some tips and tricks for providing these sorts of exercises in Canvas. So running alongside in the interior of just about every page is this vocabulary text box. It's typically set off in this off yellow gold color. And it has vocabulary at the top and then a series of vocabulary words. Those words are coming from the chapter. The chapter typically has those words bolded and highlighted for students so that they know it's important. And it's typically going to be figures, dates, events, and institutions. Students could copy the vocabulary down in their notebooks, either before reading the chapter, which I've seen many teachers do with success. If I were teaching it, I'd probably ask the students to write down the vocab word in their notebook in lieu of class notes. Like if they were taking a lecture, maybe they're going to take these vocabulary words instead. These are the most important terms and events, dates, figures, and that sort of thing. These are the items that the students really need to know for their test. I mean, it's words like Corinth and Sparta, Athens, Aristotle, and the like. So these are things that we really don't want the students to forget by the time they get out of our classrooms at the end of the sixth grade. Personally, I would make my quizzes off of these vocabulary words, keeping them pretty simple on, you know, as far as just matching, maybe matching questions, fill in the blank, multiple choice. And one pro tip that I would recommend for teachers here is to make these vocabulary quizzes cumulative, because students, if they forget something that you spent a lot of time on, it can be very disappointing and sad. If students forget, where's Sparta? Or if they ask you one day, you know, who was Plato? And they mispronounce the name of such an eminent philosopher, you don't feel like you've done your job very well. So one thing I would recommend, and one thing I love doing, is giving cumulative Quizlet sets that include all of the vocabulary words that I've covered over the course of the year. Now, I may not test the students on every vocabulary word, but I love giving them that Quizlet set so that as we review those terms in class, they're constantly being reminded as to, you know, Sparta is that militaristic society that dominated the Peloponnesian Peninsula. Plato was an Athenian philosopher who wrote down the teachings of Socrates in a series of 40 dialogues. And we want students to remember these things. And so if we create study resources like Quizlet sets and Kahoots, to an extent, I like Quizlet, but if we make these sorts of resources, we're going to make it easier for students to remember this engaging and meaningful material. The two big things that I use to make these sort of formative assessments where I'm really giving more or less like a practice quiz to see how well students are doing with the material. The two main tools that I use are Quizlet and then item banks in Canvas. And I'll explain how to make either of those. For right now, though, I'll go ahead and go over how you use Quizlet and item banks in Canvas to make formative assessments, i.e. ongoing assessments, more like practice quizzes that give students more familiarity with the material that you're covering in your class. So first with Quizlet, this is a way that either the students can test themselves, or better yet, you can test the students by giving them a Quizlet set like this. If you have the premium account for Quizlet, you can make a class and you can invite students into your class. And that way they can access a lot of the premium features for free because they're in your class and you have a pro account. Quizlet is a flashcard engine, and so you can either make each individual flashcard, i.e. you have a term on one side and the definition on the other. You can either make each of these items one at a time, or you can import a spreadsheet with, you know, column A is the term and column B is the definition. You can import such a spreadsheet, like the kind of spreadsheet that I've assembled for all the teachers, into Quizlet so that the students can access, you know, that particular set on their own. I know teachers tend to go back and forth and debate whether or not, you know, should they make the Quizlet set or ask their students to do so. And personally, me, I just found it easier to make it for them so that there was one authoritative set that that they knew they were responsible for an upcoming assessment. In addition, I could use various review games and things like that in class so that as I needed to, you know, if I had 10 minutes left of a class and I wasn't sure what to do, I could always pull out Quizlet Live to play with students. In Quizlet, you can also make multiple choice tests or matching tests based off of a flashcard set that you've made. You can tell the machine to give students, you know, 10 questions that are drawn at random from a very large set. You can print out that quiz and give it to students and take that for an accuracy grade. That gives you a kind of a snapshot of how much students are studying and how well they're absorbing the material that you're covering in class. But that's a good, relatively easy and efficient way for history teachers like us to give grades that have an accuracy component to them. If it's a matching question, you know, there's a definition and then there's four terms listed out. Only one of those is going to be right. And so that's pretty easy to take for an accuracy grade as part of maybe a bell ringer, an entrance ticket, an exit ticket, review quiz, practice quiz, whatever word that you want to use there to refer to that. There's also a way to make these sorts of exercises in Canvas, but using Canvas's item banks option. So what you can do, if you pull up your Canvas homepage, if you look to the left-hand side of your screen, you'll see a number of different hyperlinks. And down towards the bottom, there's a hyperlink for quizzes. You could click there and find the same information. And you can also click on item banks. And effectively, you can begin making many different multiple choice questions to share with students as part of some of these ongoing formative iterative assessments, practice quizzes, review quizzes, entrance quizzes, and the like. It's a little bit better for me to explain how you do that, perhaps in person, over the phone, or over Zoom, or, you know, traveling to your campus. But this item banks feature in Canvas is fantastic. So what you can do, start making maybe multiple choice questions or matching questions. You do have to physically cut and paste each individual question into the machine. But when you do that once, you don't have to do it again. If you tag it with something that's relatively easy to search, it becomes that much easier to use and reuse these question banks over a much longer period of time. When I taught logic several years ago, I had the very first item bank that I made was for chapter one in our textbook. And by the end of the year, the last item bank that I made was for chapter, I think, 15. And I had 15 item banks like that. And what I could do is I was making larger assessments or practice quizzes or what have you, is I could tell the machine to draw from a particular bank and provide students with maybe two questions or five questions, depending on how many questions were in that bank. And then students could get seemingly a brand new quiz every time they opened up that particular formative iterative assessment. So this is a really great tool utilizing the question banks and the item banks feature in Canvas. You can access it through either the link labeled as item banks along the left-hand side, or if you go into quizzes in Canvas and click on new quizzes, you can also bank your questions in this way. But those are two really great ways to come up with more practice resources for your students so that they can, you know, test themselves on how well they actually know classical Greece, how well they actually know Dark Ages Greece, and so on. For formal assessments, at Thales Academy, we ask students we ask teachers to assign really four formal assessments over the course of the quarter, and that includes two quizzes and two tests. If I were setting up a grade book at the beginning of the quarter, I would go to the very last day of the quarter, the very last day that I could give a test, and there would be my second test. That way I'm keeping the students working really right up until the end of the quarter. A week before, I might give my second vocabulary quiz, and then 2 weeks before that, I would give my first test. A week before that, I would give my first quiz. So it's really helpful to plan your formal assessments like this at the beginning of the quarter, just so that your students know what's ahead for them over the course of the track. For formal quizzes, ones that you tell students about, I base them off of vocabulary and with questions composed of matching and multiple choice. I try to keep it pretty low. It's just as on the RBT scale. These are things that the students absolutely have to know in order to talk in an engaging and an engaging way about history. With tests, though, you want more of a mix of questions, different kinds of questions, from multiple choice, true, false, short answer, and perhaps an essay. Although sixth graders, a formal essay, something you might ask your eighth graders through 12th graders to do, probably is going to be appropriate for your particular group of 12th graders. A test at Thales really should last just one class period. It's okay if students need more time, but it's best when you're designing a test to think about a student finishing that within the 45 minutes that are allotted to it. Personal recommendations is giving students a test that's maybe 60 to 70% multiple choice matching and 40% meaningful writing prompts. So that could include short answers, which may be a sentence to a paragraph, to longer, you know, short answers and essays and things like that, that might be longer paragraphs, multiple paragraphs. Those are things that you can list on your test as far as those requirements. On the PowerPoint, I'll go ahead and share the link, but there is a sixth grade history test bank. And on that test bank, it's arranged by unit. So from the Neolithic Revolution to the Bronze Age to the Romans and so forth. But this particular test bank is going to include all of those different units. And then the questions are really arranged by the type of question that they are. Multiple choice, fill in the blank, true or false, short answer, essay questions, and so on. Most of the multiple choice are taken either from reading comprehension questions, vocabulary, or questions that I came up with while I was writing the book. And I also solicited input from other sixth grade teachers that have been doing this for a long time. So if you look through here, you should be able to find, you know, a nice base that you can use to get your testing started. The last thing I'll cover is seminar teaching for our sixth graders, which is going to look different than if you're leading a seminar with students in ninth grade up through 12th grade. The heart of it, the spirit of such a seminar, isn't going to change though. A Socratic seminar is a free-flowing, formal discussion over ideas that matter. And this discussion is going to be facilitated by a great text, at times a science experiment, maybe not as applicable in sixth grade history, but that's still an element of human culture that is well worth discussing in a group, or some other similar example of human culture or natural phenomenon that spurs curiosity and wonder. These are texts, these are experiments, these are things that we see out in the world, works of art or the beauty of a sunset, that should lead students to contemplation and reflection. And we want to help bring out those sorts of deep, meaningful activities in class, facilitated by the reading and the discussion of a really great and meaningful primary source text. So with seminar teaching, I do want to distinguish between, on the one hand, seminar habits and seminar. Sometimes we look at seminar as kind of this formal event. We build up to it in class. We give students a rubric, questions. We divide them into groups, an inner circle and an outer circle. I wouldn't worry so much about a formal seminar as much as I would worry about modeling those sorts of seminar habits with students. Really, that's the best thing that you can give to your kids in your class, is that example of what it's like to read a text with a group like this, and to model what it's like to actually enjoy it. So some of those habits would include things as simple and picayune as reading the text beforehand, reading the text with students, asking the students questions, pointing the students back to the text via good questions, and always modeling for the students going back to the text for support. Asking them questions like, where do you see that? Can you support that? Like, does the author agree with that interpretation? Is that the point that he or she is trying to get at? But these are all things that you can do systematically as you walk through a, you know, primary source from the likes of Herodotus, Xenophon, Thucydides, the Bible, what have you. The primary sources that are interspersed throughout the chapter, sometimes they're at the beginning, sometimes they're in the middle, sometimes they're at the end. I try to work them in so they fit pretty naturally within the narrative of the unit under discussion, as well as the closer look activities. These all could make good seminar material, depending on your content knowledge and the particular needs of your classroom. If you feel like really overwhelmed with pacing, you know, you may not want to devote a whole lot of time to reading, you know, that third Thucydides text, but just keep in mind that the students are really going to fall in love with the study of history if you give them that best material to really chew on and meditate on. Beyond that, the soft skills, the soft habits that a seminar teacher is going to have, I would argue that you're going to have a conviction that all students can learn, understand, and participate. Even if they're reading something pretty difficult, like Thucydides, for instance, you still have that conviction that students can get this stuff. Students can pick up on the really meaningful insights that Thucydides brings out, because Thucydides is ultimately writing about human nature, just using the war as a vehicle to do so. A seminar teacher is going to be inquisitive, and that your main mode of instruction is going to be by asking questions. So asking students to do things as simple as summarizing the material under discussion, but also asking them very pointed, you know, content-driven questions by particular turns of phrase in a paragraph somewhere. But your mode of instruction is inquisitive, And also, you've got to model really enjoying and loving those sorts of questions as well. And the seminar teacher is going to be patient. You guys, you know, sixth grade teachers, you know that students are not going to get this stuff inside of a single class period, maybe not even a month. For some kids, it may, you know, take years for something to really begin to click. I remember as a Latin teacher, I remember as a Latin student, how much I struggled with various grammatical concepts. And sometimes some piece of Latin grammar would click for me well after the test had been given. But I at least was happy that I got it then at some point before the year was over. But some elements of Latin grammar didn't click for me until I was in college and still, you know, working through how to identify nouns by their declensions and things like that. It's just difficult. So as teachers, we have to remember what it was like for us to learn this stuff and be patient, knowing that students are not going to develop these habits or internalize these lessons inside of a single lesson. We have to continually bring students back to the text and back to the drawing board and remind them of the things that are true, good, and beautiful, and really worth studying. Some key takeaways for seminars, though. I wouldn't recommend grading students on how much they've spoken. At times, that may encourage students to speak more often and think less, which I think as teachers is something we don't want to encourage students to do. If you write questions beforehand, consider grading their answers like some sort of in-class writing assignment. And reflection pieces are also a good follow-up exercise for seminar. And depending on the class size, consider dividing students up into different groups. Sometimes we speak of an inner circle and an outer circle. The inner circle might be maybe a quarter of the class to half the class. And those students are responsible for driving the course of the discussion for that particular class period. The students that are in the outer circle are really taking notes on the flow of the discussion and how the students in the inner circle are dissecting the text and, you know, explaining and interpreting its themes and so forth. One thing that you can also consider in place of notes or probably maybe in addition to notes is a conversation map. And what a conversation map is a visual demonstration or diagram of a seminar discussion that maybe you keep or you ask a couple of students to keep. But basically, you're trying to visualize points that were made, insights that were offered, questions that were raised over the course of the discussion. And that might be a good way to break down such a seminar after the seminar has taken place. You know, if you've got a relatively big seminar and you want to do something like this, if the seminar is big because the text is important, then maybe you show this conversation map with your students here. I personally really like it, and sometimes I'll do a conversation map on the whiteboard. That way students can see and visualize the points that are being made, because it's hard for students to follow a conversation as it's unfolding. Some students just need to see it in addition to hearing it if they're really going to get it. And so I like doing this just to try to provide one more way for students to follow the discussion and go where we're going. If you had an outer circle and an inner circle, here would be that inner circle there, and these are the students that are offering various contributions. Meanwhile, the students in the outer circle are here, and they're by and large taking notes. It's difficult to keep these students on task. You may still have to circulate around the classroom. You could switch the students, you know, midway through the class, perhaps the next day, but that way everybody gets an opportunity to discuss the really rich, content-rich text that you're reading with those kids. The last thing that I want to leave you guys as you walk through the Thales Canon with your students in sixth grade is just to encourage you all to cultivate a love for reading, for experimenting, for problem solving, and discussing ideas of great value and significance. Like Socrates, we are gadflies. You know, we are spurring kids on to think about and focus on things that are good, true, and beautiful. And if students discover those ideas for themselves, those ideas are going to stick with them for life. So I want to commend you all and thank you all so much for what you do on behalf of our students at Thales Academy and students at other like-minded classical schools. If there's anything that we can do to assist you in your educational journey, please reach out to us at thalespress@thalesacademy.org, or you can reach me at my email address at winston.brady@thalesacademy.org. It's my joy to help teachers and students really learn the things that are worth loving. So if there's anything I can do, please let me know. So for Thales Press, I'm Winston Brady. Until next time, stay classy and stay classical.